Welcome to another Top 8. I'm back here with the Hall of Famer, William Jensen, at Huey Jensen on Twitter. You can find him on when he streams. He's on a little bit of a hiatus right now, but you can find him on twitch.tv/HueyWJ. Thank you so much for joining me, Huey. It is Moshi Scanlon, the guy that left at Moshi Scanlon across all social media. And we got a spicy one here. I'm pretty happy. We just wrapped up doing top four enchantments. So if you haven't checked that out, you can check that one out. But this one is really, really interesting. Huey said this was the more interesting list, so we saved it for last. We had our dinner.
I was amazed with how hard this one was. I was like, are we even going to find eight that we want to rank? But then it was actually like, wow, these are some good cards.
We had to bring in Luis for number eight. We had so many trying to get to weed things down to number eight. Yeah, so that was great for him. Before we dive into that, I want to remind everyone, right now we have Credit for a Cause. You can use your store credit on channelfireball.com. You can give it to one of three causes. You can give it to the World Health Organization COVID Project. You can give it to the Trevor Project, or you can give it to the NAACP Legal Defense Fund. You go on channelfireball.com. You can click the medallion and use your store credit to donate to any of those charities. Of course, if you already have store credit, it's easy peasy. If you don't have store credit, you can trade in your stuff on the buy list. The best part is we don't donate the cash amount that we buy it from you for. We donate the store credit amount. So it's a 30% bump. Check that out. It's awesome. It's a wonderful thing. Credit for a cause. So take a look at that. All right. Here we go, Huey. We have top eight blue Enter the Battlefield Creatures, ETB. So they used to be called something else when we were younger. And I don't know, is 187, is that like a, is that a term we shouldn't be using? I wasn't even sure if that was a term we shouldn't be using anymore.
I think it's, I don't know.
I'm not sure. It's weird, but they used to be called 187 creature. 187, for those who don't know, is the kind of police code for homicide, meaning there's an effect that happens right away. So when we were younger, we called them 187 creatures, but we'll say enter the battlefield creatures now. All right, a few honorable mentions before we dive into our list. This one shouldn't even be on the list, but I just wanted to talk about it. I will never have the chance to really talk about this creature again. Knight of the Mists. Do you know what Knight of the Mists does, Huey?
Obviously, I know what it does. It's a blue and two.
Okay.
2/2 flanking. When it enters the battlefield, destroy target knight unless you pay blue. Pay a blue?
Yep. Yep. Bury it. You bury that knight.
My bad. I got it wrong.
We talked about this earlier with Control Magic. This was blue removal. Obviously, it was a sideboard card. You didn't main deck this thing.
Oh, I don't know about that. There were a lot of knights. This card was pretty popular in some of those. There were like these three-color Necrotog deck, so it's like Song of the Something, where you like milled four of your own deck, and every creature gave all your creatures +1/+0 till end of turn.
Oh, that's right, Song of the Damned,
Song of Blood.
I remember what you're talking about. Song of Blood might be right.
Doesn't sound right, but it might be. But anyway, the long and short of it was like everybody was playing so many knights, you would just play this thing, and occasionally it was a 4-mana 2/2 flanking, and you just made do with what you had.
It was also just a way to like blow up, right? Your opponent's black knights, white knights. Okay, I'm trying to think what other knights. Pump knights, yeah, Knight of Stromgold. Okay, Fallen Askari. Fallen Askari is a knight, I believe.
Yeah.
Yeah, Fallen Askaris were out there. So there were a bunch of knights, and you would use this, and obviously if your opponent's not on blue, you would just be killing their knight. And you still get a 2/2 flanking body. By the way, it is Song of Blood, Huey, one red, one other sorcery. Put the top four cards from your library into your graveyard. For each creature card put into your graveyard in this way, all creatures that attack this turn get +1/+0 until end of turn. So yeah, you do that to pump up all your creatures. This is a weenie strategy. I'm trying to think about, I think it was, I want to say Jakob Slemmer may have played like five color total weenie bad stuff in Worlds one year, like in 96 or 97. And he might have had Knight of the Mist was pretty good against that deck, I remember, because it had I think you
there are
you
a lot of like, knights for real.
Yeah,
a lot.
Yeah, yeah. Fallen Askari, all the pump knights, white knight, black knight saw a ton of play because you couldn't plow it. So yeah, there was an era, right, where this was like a legit removal spell. So I love the card. I played with it a lot, so I wanted to get my my honorable mention of Knight of the Mists out there. Two other quick honorable mentions. One, we have to look, we're both friends with Marshall. If we don't honorable mention Manowar, we're gonna be off the Christmas list, Huey. We're gonna be off the Christmas list.
Yeah, when you first mentioned this list, I was like, well, Manowar's gotta be number one. I mean, and then I was like, well, no, that card's clearly number one. And then I thought for another second, it's like, wow, okay, this card is definitely better than Manowar. And then I'm just like, and that one, and that one, uh-oh.
Yeah, I mean, I think we had Manowar, I think, in my head too, I was like, well, Manowar's gotta make the top eight somewhere. And even when we had a debate about top eight, about number eight, Manowar wasn't part of that debate. So sorry, sorry, Marshall. Sorry, Manowar. One blue, two other for a 2/2 jellyfish. When Manowar enters the battlefield, return target creature to its owner's hand.
Iconic card. Of all the cards we're going to talk about, I bet this is the one I've cast the most. And this is not including a card on the list that I theoretically could have cast infinite times or whatever in a single game. I'm not counting that. I'm saying times I played it, Manowar has to be number one on this list for me.
I think it might be number one. Yeah, I think it's number one on this list for me too. I played a lot of Manowars. It is actually one of my favorite cards. If you start counting limited, it's easily number one for me because I've played a lot of limited formats that have Manowar in it. So Manowar, a great. Is it the best jellyfish of all time?
No, Hydroid Crisis.
Oh, is Hydroid Crisis a jellyfish?
Yeah.
Oh my God. Sorry, man. Well, Manowar would certainly make the top eight list for top eight.
It would probably be like number two.
Yeah, I think it might be number two. So Manowar gets an honorable mention. Now, one of the cards that was in a heated debate for the number eight slot, Spellstutter Sprite. One blue, one other for a 1/1 flash, flying fairy wizard. When Spellstutter Sprite enters the battlefield, counter target spell with converted mana cost X or less, where X is the number of fairies you control. With no other fairies, it'll counter a one mana spell. But of course, you played this in a fairies deck and was a pretty effective aggressive counterspell.
Usually, I think, was around.
Yep. At a pinch, you'd tap the Mutavault to activate itself. Mutavault, of course, has Changeling. So now the Spellstutter Sprite counters a two-mana spell.
Yeah, exactly. I haven't played a lot with this card, but it seems to me like I have seen it played against me mostly in formats where there are a lot of one- and two-mana cards. Like in formats full of Thought Seizes and Lightning Bolts and Inquisitions of Kozilek and Fatal Pushes, Spellstutter Sprite's just a really strong card.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Sprite was really good. It was kind of a bulwark in fairies too, because it fits so well in that deck. And you know, you had your Fairy Lord, you had your Mistbind Click if you needed to champion it. Because keep in mind, you know, Mistbind, you had to champion something, so you needed a fairy in play to remove, and Spellstutter Sprite could fill that role. Yeah, of course you have tons of Bitter Blossom tokens. I mean, can you imagine how out of hand this card got when you had Bitter Blossom in play with pumping out fairy after fairy after fairy? So yeah, it was a legit counter for a long time, but it didn't quite make the list. It did get the honorable mention. Number eight, the card that displaced Spellstutter Sprite from our list, at the suggestion, at the behest, at one Luis Scott the demand. Vargas. Yeah. The demand of LSV Muldrifter. One blue, four over for an elemental creature. It's a 2/2 flyer. When Muldrifter enters the battlefield, draw two cards, and it has an evoke cost of one blue, two other. So at worst, it was a divination. At best, it was a five mana. Actually, I don't even know if that's at best, but you could get a five mana 2/2 flyer and still draw two off of it. Were you playing a ton when Muldrifter and five color control and all that nonsense was happening, Huey?
I wasn't. I've almost never seen Muldrifter played in Constructed. However, I played the Modern Horizons or Modern Masters. I forget which I forget the difference in names, but that limited format I played a lot, where Muldrifter was one of the best cards. I also have played a fair bit of Cube, in which Muldrifter was always in various cubes. Like one of my best friends had a cube. I would play that sometimes. A former coworker had a cube. We would get together and play that sometimes. Muldrifter was all over those. So I've definitely cast in a lot of Muldrifters. Just not in Constructed.
So Muldrifter was a huge, huge player in five color control, cruel control. You could go Grixis, you could go five color. Back in this time, right? You know, you had the Vivid Lands where they could tap, you remove a counter, you add one mana of any color to your mana pool. Well, you have something like that with Reflecting Pool. Reflecting Pool gives you one mana of any color that a land you control could produce. So you have both of these in play. Your Reflecting Pool is effectively, you know, a five color land. So you play five color control. Your end spell was Cruel Tomatum. Muldrifter. These decks were incredibly card hungry. You wanted to get a bunch of mana in play. They had a very, very high end. You know, you play Broodmate Dragon, you know, Cruel Tomatum. So you wanted to get a lot of land and a lot of spells. And Muldrifter was a real bulwark there because, you know, in a pinch, if you need to play defense, sure, it was a 5-mana 2/2, but it was your divination and it had a body on it as well. Now, Luis mentioned that Muldrifter did win a Pro Tour. And of course, Luis fell to Gabriel Nassif in the finals of Kyoto when Luis was playing blue-white tokens. And Nassif was on five-color control. I'm sure there's no bias there, but Muldrifter, undeniably a great, great card. There were various elemental decks at that time in Standard as well that played Muldrifter. Muldrifter was everywhere, right? It was a utility spell. It was everywhere. You saw it all everywhere in Standard at that time. So that's why it made number 8 on our list. Number 7, maybe I guess you might say the inspiration for this list. Number 7, we've seen a lot of this person recently. Agent of Treachery. 2 blue, 5 other for a 2/3 human rogue. When Agent of Treachery enters the battlefield, gain control of target permanent. At the beginning of your end step, if you control 3 or more permanents you don't own, draw 3 cards. Oi, Agent of Treachery. Now, this one I know you have played a bit of.
I've played a ton with and against it, yeah. I mean, one of the best cards in Standard for the past, I've lost track of time now. Time has no meaning anymore. But,
of course,
you know, year and a half, I don't know. You know, 7 mana, take control of any of your opponent's permanents right away, including lands. Super powerful effect. I think the Standard ban will basically be the end of Agent of Treachery. Maybe we could see a little bit in Pioneer. We won't see it in Modern and Legacy, in my opinion.
I agree.
A strong card on its own. I don't know if it necessarily would have been banned if not for Luka. I think it probably wouldn't, but you never know. Just a super powerful effect. I mean, 7 mana, take control of any permanent. Really good against Planeswalkers because you can sort of do the bait and switch, let your opponent get their Planeswalker up to almost ultimate, take it ultimate, stuff like that. Just gaining control of an opponent's permanent without an enchantment on it, so they can't really be disenchanted, can only be bounced. I don't know. A comfortable number 7, I'd say.
That's what always got me about Agent of Treachery, by the way, is the fact that it wasn't, you know, you kind of effects like this when you're stealing things, you expect them to end if the source is gone, right? So, but right. It wasn't like that with Agent of Treachery. When I take it, you can kill my agent. Go ahead. I still got your shiny. Doesn't matter to me. I will say I grossly underestimated this card, by which I mean I never gave it a second thought. I remember seeing it in M20 thinking, 7 mana. Next, like, come on. I get that it's a 7 mana 2/3. Yeah, I get that as an effect, but come on, 7 mana in this format with, you know, all this power creep and creatures. So I was blown away. I completely dismissed this card when I first saw it in M20 as anything, because I thought this is an aggressive Standard. They're like, you don't have time to be casting Agent of Treachery. So I very much underestimated this card when I first saw it. I will cop to that for sure. Ooh, okay. Number 6 on our list. This is a whole cycle of cards. We're going to say Cloud of Fairies, but there's a whole cycle of Great Whale, Palancron, different creatures that had this ability. I think it was Cloud of Fairies, I think, probably the most iconic, has seen the most play due to its lower mana cost, but it's 1 blue,
I'm
one
not
other.
Sure. I played Great Whale on a Pro Tour and I played a lot of Palancron. Cloud of Fairies is more played now because it's a good card in Popper. Mm-hmm. In my opinion, but like I played survival decks where I would just put in a Great Whale and a Palancron with like a Priest of Gix, and then you just had infinite mana with a recurring nightmare,
right?
Or things like that. The first extended Pro Tour, I think it was the first extended Pro Tour, Tomi Hovi won with Academy. Like I played a deck of Dave Humphrey's design that had Great Whale and Peregrine Drake in it before Palancron had ever been printed, but no Cloud of Fairies. So I do think Cloud of Fairies has seen more play because of Popper, but I don't think back then when the cards were new and fresh, it was that way.
Oh, I agree with you there. Cloud of Fairies, for those keeping score, 1 blue, 1 other for a 1/1 flyer. When Cloud of Fairies enters the battlefield, untap up to 2 lands. And then, of course, the hidden ability on the Cloud of Fairies, it also cycles for 2. What I was thinking, though, is I think Cloud of Fairies was in a lot of, I want to say it was in early builds. I don't know if it still is, of Alluren. You'd play Alluring, oh, sure, and you had, yeah, Cloud of Fairies. And there were, I don't know if that was Legacy or Extended or what, with Cloud of Fairies, Alluring. And that's where I remember seeing a ton of Cloud of Fairies type stuff in the Alluring decks. So, but in Standard, I agree with you. I think it was way more. There were a lot of Palancron dot decks I remember floating around, early versions of Standard when Urza's when Urza's block was just dropping. Of course, was this a Legacy ability? Is this all Urza's Legacy? Or Peregrine Drake is Saga. No,
the Great Whale was Saga, and the Drake was Saga. Palancron and Cloud Fairies were Legacy.
Legacy, okay. So
pretty sure.
Why would they do, boy, you talk about, I mean, it's not like it's bad. It's bad enough this is in one set. To have it go through the whole block is just insane. This ability is crazy. Obviously, one of the things you do with this ability, regardless of the body it's attached to, is you find a way to have lands that tap for more than one mana. And once you do that, you profit. And this was an era where you could find many different ways to do that. So the undeniable power of something like Cloud of Fairies, and it was weird. I wasn't even sure. I don't even think of it as a come into play ability, like an ETB. I was like, does this even count as an ETB? Clearly it does when Cloud of Fairies enters the battlefield, untap up to two lands. But I never really thought of it that way because I kind of was more thinking of things like Agent of Treachery or,
right, you know, I get it. Yeah.
And stuff. Yeah. So, but yes, very, very, very much earning this whole ability its spot on the list. That's why we have it at number six. Number five, we talked about this on our last top eight. It's kind of a split spot. I'm going to go with Pestermite here. One blue, two other for another Fairy Rogue. A 2/1 flash flying. When Pestermite enters the battlefield, you may tap or untap target permanent. This is split between Pestermite and Deceiver Exarch because of the Splinter Twin combo. I know you didn't play much with Pestermite when it was in Type 2 or Standard. You weren't playing Standard in those days, but obviously Pestermite, Deceiver Exarch, this slot exists because of the Splinter Twin combo.
Right. Like, I've definitely played some with Splinter Twin myself and plenty against it. I think this is sort of like the Illusions Donate thing or the Splinter Twin on the last list. Obviously, the card by itself wouldn't make the list. Mm-hmm. But the fact of the matter is Splinter Twin does exist. And for that reason, these cards saw a ton of play in Modern, which was one of the most popular formats in Magic for the years that the deck was one of the most popular decks in the format. And so I think it's very safe to include these two on the list.
Yeah. Oh, I agree. They're also kind of iconic because of that lurking fear we talked about where, you know, once they had that crack and they hit three mana, you never knew when you were going to see Deceiver Exarch or a Pestermite hit play. And then if they untapped, that could be game. So that was a huge, huge, there's kind of that fear, that three mana fear. All right, there we go. Those are our bottom four for our blue Enter the Battlefield creatures. Number eight was Moldrifter. Number seven, Agent of Treachery. Number six, Cloud of Fairies. And that whole cycle of untapped creatures, Peregrine Drake, Great Whale, Palancron. Number five was the Pestermite Deceiver Exarch. We still have four left. If you're watching us, hit pause. Give us your guesses. Leave it in the comments. You know, be honest.
You better get number one.
Number one is pretty obvious.
You better get number one. That's all I'm saying. If you don't get number one out there, you're going to be kicking yourself.
Well, number one is the best ETB creature, period, I think.
Yeah.
I think it's just number one in all the lists. So obviously it's got to be
number one.
Might
be the best creature.
In blue. It might be the best creature, actually. I think there's a good shot it's the best creature. That
I don't want to give anything away, but it might be the best creature because it's only sort of a creature. You know, you kind of get non-creature. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah. You get a lot of value out of it. Of course, the reason that Enter the Battlefield stuff is so great is you get that extra value. I will say, you know, doing a top eight blue Enter the Battlefield creature list with Huey Jensen, it's funny because one of the first cards that came to mind does not have an Enter the Battlefield effect. You know what creature I'm talking about? Talking about Huey. What creature?
Phyrexian Metamorph.
That is not what I was talking about. Oh no. You corrected it because it was what I was saying is it's something that's reminiscent of both you, William Jensen, particularly to me, and involves Enter the Battlefield creatures, is blue, but is not an Enter the Battlefield, does not have an Enter the Battlefield effect. Any idea? This is reaching back in the mists of time.
No, I'm not sure.
Tradewind Rider.
Oh, sure. Like, because you can bounce your own stuff.
You can bounce your own. Yeah, and so it was funny, and I was like, oh, Tradewind, and I realized, wait a minute, Tradewind does not have an Enter the Battlefield effect. But you bring up a really, really good point, Huey. We should tell everyone why there are no clones and Phyrexian Metamorph not part of this list. We should clarify that now.
Well, I told Mashi had Metamorph, and we were discussing it, and I said, like, look, for my money, I just don't believe or don't feel that as enters is the same as when enters. Like, it has to be a trigger to be an enters the battlefield creature to me, not like you, as it enters the battlefield, you copy something. I just thought that was something else.
I agree with you. No, I think you were totally right. Yeah. And I still agree with that.
Yeah. Also, no clones. Like, there's so many clones, you know?
Yeah. I mean, yeah.
We could have spent all day. We could do top eight clones. That could just be a top eight. Yeah.
That could be its own top eight. I agree.
And clone wouldn't make it.
Clone would not make it. Vesuvian Doppelganger wouldn't make it.
Vesuvian Doppelganger was like the chase card when we were younger. Nobody ever put that card into play. It's never been done.
No.
I don't know why people liked it.
Have you seen a beta or alpha doppelganger? It is gorgeous.
Every alpha card is gorgeous, though.
That one in particular, though, I want to say it's Quentin Hoover art. It is choice, as they say in Ireland. It is a choice piece of art. It is unbelievable.
I love the Stephen Doppelganger. I have nothing to say bad about it. I'm just saying, like, nobody's ever cast it.
No, not in any kind of competitive format. It is. So, but it is, I agree, it was like a $20, I want to say it was $20, $25 card at some point, and just because it was the Vesuvian Doppelganger. So, all right, number four on our list of blue enter the battlefield creatures, Torrential Gearhole. Two blue, four other for an artifact creature, a construct, a 5/6 artifact construct. It's got flash. When Torrential Gearhulk enters the battlefield, you may cast target instant card from your graveyard without paying its mana cost. If that card would be put into your graveyard this turn, exile it instead.
Yeah, Torrential Gearhulk kind of, for my money, took standard control decks, threw them on his back, and just ran them across the finish line for basically the entire time he was in standard. I don't think those decks would have existed without him, and I found Torrential Gearhulk to be one of the more fun sort of control win conditions ever, just because it gave so much value when you cast it. It was like, they attack, it was like, all right, Gearhulk, my removal spell, kill that creature, block that creature, untap, attack your planeswalker or whatever. And they're like, it's like, okay, well, that's it. I'm dead.
Yeah. No, it is unbelievable, right? Because you're playing control, so you got a bunch of instants in your graveyard, obviously, because you're building around Torrential Gearhulk. And it's just like, it's almost like you're recasting that instant from your graveyard on off, but you get put a 5/6 body into play. It's just unbelievable the access it gives you. What's the Chainer's Edict ability? Flashback. It's like you're flashing back whatever instant is in your graveyard, and you're at for 6 mana, and you're adding a 5/6 body to it. It was pretty demoralizing when you walked into a Torrential Gearhulk like that. And sometimes you just couldn't avoid it. If you're the aggro player, you've got to attack. You can't just sit there and let yourself get moated or whatever the whole time. Like, you know, that there's no moat in play, but there's a Torrential Gearhulk that could be coming at you. So it's just, it was very, very frustrating. And it was those times when you knew that Gearhulk was coming down and you had no way to really play around it. So, yeah, I agree. Torrential Gearhulk was a huge player and made control really, really viable while it was in standard.
Yep.
Number three, Vendilin Click. Two white, one other for a legendary fairy wizard. Although I always thought this should be legendary fairy wizards because, you know, it's a click and there are three fairies in the image. So 3/1 flash flying. When Vendilin Click enters the battlefield, look at target player's hand. You may choose a non-land card from it. If you do, that player reveals the chosen card, puts it on the bottom of his or her library, then draws a card. V-click. Here's an interesting question for V-click. Have you V-clicked your opponent more or yourself more?
My opponent by far.
Okay.
Yeah.
I think I'm in the same category too. But
ironically, the card I most played, the deck I most played Vendilion Click in was the Splintertwin deck. And like, you're always like, is the coast clear? Yes. Yep. Or is the coast clear? No. It is occasionally true. Even in that deck, you're like, well, I have 3 Deceiver XRX and nothing else. Like, I need another card here. But
cycle it.
Mostly clear the way for me.
Yeah, I'm with you. It was one of those things where if you got stuck on something or needed something, the fact that you could cycle out of your own hand was just that nice little added bonus. It made Vendilin Click like feel so bad. V-Click is just, yeah. Check to see if the coast's clear. You know what counters you're backing. Maybe it's a spell stutter. Maybe if it was standard, it would be spell stutter. If it's not standard, then it's, you know, something else. It's a 3/1 body. You get to see what your opponent has. You get to know what their whole game plan is. You get to cycle away their best card. And by the way, if they just have a bunch of crap, just let them keep it. Like, who cares, right?
Yeah, for sure. You don't have to let them give them an advantage.
Right, right. That was the best part about it, is because a lot of times with things like this, you have to commit. You have to take one. You have to let them cycle it. The fact that V-Click gave you the flexibility to say, no, you know what? You got four lands. Why don't you just stay on four lands? I'm not going to let you cash one of those in for something new. So that's why V-Click very, very easily makes the list here. Number two on this list is a card I've actually never played with. Coming in number two on our list, Urza, Lord High Artificer. 2 blue, 2 other for a 1/4 legendary human artificer. Everybody knows Urza. He has one of the most powerful, if not, I think possibly probably the most powerful block in the history of Magic, named after him.
I think it's the most powerful, but that's an aside. Top 8 blocks? No, there's not enough to do a top 8 probably. But anyway.
Yeah, I think it's number one top 8. Let me get through the... He's got a lot going on here. When Urza Lord Artificer enters the battlefield, create a 0/0 colorless construct artifact creature token with, quote, this creature gets +1/+1 for each artifact you control. You can tap an untapped artifact you control to add 1 blue mana to your mana pool. You can tap 5, shuffle your library, then exile the top card. Until end of turn, you may play that card without paying its mana cost. So Urza, you know, can Urza does a ton. It's a Temple Aperture, can give you mana. It just does a little bit of everything. Urza,
with artifacts, it's like a 4-mana 1/4 and also a 4/4. So like even if it gets killed, right, if Urza gets removed right away, you still have value. Even redundant copies aren't that bad because you get the creature. Just everything that would necessarily be negative about Urza is a positive. I haven't played a ton of Modern since Urza has been printed. At the Pro Tour, I played Hogak. I thought that was a better choice than Urza, though I tested Urza a bit. But Urza, especially after the banning of Hogak in Modern, Urza's been all the rage. I think these Urza decks have been among the best decks for the entire time, and I suspect they'll continue to be. Urza's just such a strong card.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Unbelievable. He slices, he dices, he makes Julian fries. Also, it was nice to see Urza. And I know there's an unset Urza, but one of the things we see now with M21 is we've got Baron. We've got another Baron card, but we had a Baron card before. Now we get Urza, you know, for the first time ever as a creature card in Modern Horizons. So it was really, really cool to see that for anyone who, you know, was into lore back in the day. Okay, we hinted at it. We talked about it. Number one with a bullet. Easy number one. No question. I know we may have gotten 7 of these cards wrong, Huey, but I know we got number one right. I'm dead sure.
I think
sure
we did. I mean, yeah. I'm pretty sure too.
Number one, Snapcaster Mage. 1 blue, 1 other for a 2/1 for a 2/1 human wizard with flash. When Snapcaster Mage enters the battlefield, target instant or sorcery card in your graveyard gains flashback until end of turn. The flashback cost is equal to its mana cost. Unbelievable card. Snapcaster Mage.
I mean, Snapcaster Mage has basically been one of the best cards in every format it's been legal in since it's been printed, right? It was one of the best cards in Standard. It's still one of the best cards in Modern and Legacy. I don't know about Vintage very much, but it's probably fine there. I mean, any format with Ancestral, it can't be that bad. It turns out just like tacking a 2/1 flash onto a Lightning Bolt is just really valuable, or tacking a 2/1 flash onto a Thoughtseize is really valuable, especially in formats where people are playing Planeswalkers, and they're sort of forced to spend cards and dealing with this 2/1. And I don't know, like, I don't know if anybody would ever look at the card and see exactly the impact it would have on so many formats over so much time. I wouldn't, but that's not my strong suit. Maybe there are people who would.
I mean, I thought the card was good. I had no concept of how good Snapcaster was when it was printed. You know, obviously we've talked about this and alluded to it in this top 8, but there's arguments that I think are correct that Snapcaster Mage is the greatest creature right now. It's the best creature in Magic. And I'm struggling to think of a creature that's better than a Snapcaster Mage. I mean,
there's things you could argue. I mean, Hermit Druid
Hermit Druid, yeah, that's a blast from the past. Hogak
or something. Like, Hogak is just, it's different. It doesn't, that's functionally not a creature. Narcomoeba, like, that's functionally not a creature. It's just something else. It's weird.
Snapcaster Mage, though,
Snapcaster Mage is better than Narcomoeba, but yeah. I know what I you're saying.
It's functionally kind of like not a creature, too, though, right?
Yeah, maybe you're right. Maybe, you know, maybe it's like if it made a 2/1 token and did the same thing, maybe I would be like, of course, it's not. I don't know, but I get your point. Hermit Druid is the one that I think is like, Hermit Druid was like, people don't understand, it's banned in every format, so they've never seen it. But Hermit Druid was just in decks where it was a 2-mana 1/1, and if you untap, the game ended. Literally.
There is a bit of a, I gotta say, I think there's like a bit of a, an almost YMG bias in some of the analysis we're getting here. Because wasn't it YMG that brought that to the Pro Tour? I think it was it a Pro Tour or was
they,
it?
They played maybe Hermit Druid in something, but the top, when I remember really it breaking out was, I might have the city wrong, but I think it was a Pro Tour in New Orleans where Bob Maher played it.
Oh, okay, okay. Yeah, Hermit Druid was oppressive, but yeah, banned everywhere. So I guess a non-banned card. Snapcaster has my vote for best creature out there right now. The thing about Snapcaster, and this is similar, I mean, obviously Torrential Gearhulk ability is kind of a aping the Snapcaster ability, not quite as good, way more expensive and instance only. But Snapcaster, you build decks that have efficient sorceries and efficient instance, really efficient instance, in them to best use Snapcaster. You get that flashback cost, and of course the Snapcaster can still hold a sword if you have a sword, or you know, still hold a battle scroll if you have a battle scroll. I don't know, you know, anything you want, or just get in there for two over and over, killing planeswalkers and ultimately killing you. You get so much value, and there's so the Snapcaster makes you so efficiently costed. 2 mana flash 2/1. And you get the best instant and or sorcery in your graveyard back, or the most needed instant and or sorcery, or not and or, instant or sorcery in your graveyard back. It's just unbelievable how powerful Snapcaster is.
For sure.
Rightfully and deservedly number one on our list of top 8 blue enter the battlefield creatures. All right. Take a moment. Let us know what we got right, please. Because as I said,
and let us know what you think for next week should be number one of top 8 invitational cards ever made.
Did you ever make an invitation?
That was a joke because Snapcaster Mages won. No, I didn't make one.
You never did a draft or anything? You never played the Invitational?
I never played in it, no. There was a period in my younger prime, let's call it my younger prime, where there was like 3 years in a row, I think, I would have made it based on the previous year's criteria, but it kept changing. And I don't think it was malicious or anything, and no ill will. I'm just saying, like, there was some short period of 2 or 3 years where I would have made it every year based on the way they did the tournament the year before, but they kept changing it, like, you know, in plenty of time. And I'm not complaining. I didn't get the short end of the stick, but, like, I just kept sort of doing well in the wrong way. I had done it in the previous year, I would have gotten in. It would have been a cool tournament to play, but I never got to.
Oh man, hey, that's so weird. I just kind of assumed you'd played in a few of those. So, wow, did you ever think about what your invitational card would have been?
No, my understanding is there was a lot of help. People got a lot of help on how to design their cards from R&D. Like, I think the submitted cards were often just absurd, like way too powerful.
Oh my God, John's card was insane, right?
0-mana Wrath of God. Yeah, that was a pretty good one. Yeah.
Supreme Verdict was a little bit of validation for him. It's the closest thing that we've seen to, what was it, Hand of Lechnif? Is that what it was called? Yeah. So, I mean, Kai's card, Wise Drafter's Will, the initial one, do you remember what that was?
No.
I think it was telepathy that you could sack. It was a telepathy. I can't remember. It's been so long. That I think you could also, at some point, just pay 2 blue and sack to counter a spell.
Yeah, that's ridiculous.
So it's like, turn one, I'll play telepathy, and then I'll just sit here and wait.
Then you lose. Especially if Kai plays it, you know?
Yeah.
If he can see your whole hand and decide what to counter, it's absurd.
Yeah, so
but they're just not going to print that card. That's sort of my point, you know what I mean?
Of course.
And he got punished. He got punished big time for even suggesting it. By Void Mage Prodigy.
Void Mage Prodigy is so... So also very unflattering art of Kai in the original version of that, unfair and unflattering. But yeah, that card was so good. I mean, there was an era when Rootwater Thief was an invitational card. Yeah. Rootwater Thief is also a 1 blue, 1 other blue creature. Does not have an enter the battlefield effect, but nowhere near the power level. Rootwater Thief cannot hold Snapcaster Mage's boots. You know what I'm saying?
Meddling Mage was good. Avalanche Riders was the second best one.
I think a lot of people like Bob's.
Oh, of course. Yeah, I'm done. Yeah, of course. So, but Star Confidant's number 2, Avalanche Rider's number 3, then Meddling Mage, then Shadow Mage Infiltrator. Well, maybe Solemn Simulacrum's better than Shadow Mage Infiltrator.
Because Shadow Mage Infiltrator's not that. I mean, it was a victim of Wild Mongrel, right? Wild Mongrel just stopped Shadow Mage.
Well, also, it was just printed in the same format as Psychotog. So for that cost, you could just have a Psychotog, which was much better.
Yep.
And then there was also Ole Rade's card. Sylvan Safekeeper was an okay sideboard card at times.
Yeah, it didn't. It didn't see a ton. And then there's
Augur Mage. I forgot Olivier's card, Ranger of Eos.
Oh, that Ranger of Eos card is good. Too. Yeah, Ranger of Eos is good. And then Rakdos Augur Mage is terrible. So that
I
card.
I don't even know that one.
It's not good.
Okay, but, I trust you, given that I've never heard of it.
Yeah, it's not playable. All right, there you have it. That was like a bonus top eight. Bonus top eight.
Javier's card kind of counts, right? It wasn't an invitational card. He's on it.
It was an invitational card. It would.
It wasn't.
If it were, if, I don't if know. It were an invitational card, though. It would be.
Did
top
he design
eight.
It, or is he just? Or, I don't know.
I have no idea. I don't know if he's just featured on it. If that were an invitational card, though, it would easily make the top eight.
Oh yeah, probably around eighth, but yeah.
I think. Do you think it's better than Ranger of Eos?
No.
No. Okay. Have to think about it. Wow. All right. We'll have to revisit this topic at some future date. But all right. There you have it. Thank you so much to Huey for joining us we went a little bit long, but we had a good time. A lot of old school stuff. We should just do a Magic TV where all we do is talk about old school stuff. But
we do that every time we're together. We don't need a special episode. Yeah.
All we do is talk about all these old tournaments and old events and mention Magic players no one's ever heard of or remembers and combos no one ever remembers. But it's always a blast for me. So thank you so much, Huey. Thanks for taking time to join us for this. This is a blast. Next week I'll be back. It'll be kind of a throwback top eight. My understanding is TBS is available and he saw, hey, you're doing top eights again. So TBS will be joining me next week. I think he wants to do top eight core sets. Not a promise. We'll see. But until then, thank you to Huey Jensen. Big shout out. Check him out at Huey Jensen. Of course, the best stuff on his Twitter has seemed to cease. I don't see my daily Lyra photos anymore, Huey. That was a big part of my day, seeing the daily Lyra photo. If you follow Huey, hopefully we can peer pressure him into. He was posting a morning picture of his gorgeous dog, LD Lyra. She's super pretty, and that was a great. It's a great way to start the day. So give Huey a follow at Huey Jensen. When he starts streaming again, twitch.tv/HueyWJ. I am the guy on the left at Moshi Scanlon across all social media platforms. Thank you so much for joining us for this top eight. Until next week and next time, be wonderful to yourselves and be wonderful to each other. We'll see you next week.
Take care, everybody.